evening, everyone. I'm Christine Pulliam, and I want to welcome you to Observatory Night at the Harvard Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics. Tonight, we're going to address the weighty topic of black holes. I hope that we will draw you in and capture your attention. Couldn't resist. That's one thing that black holes do well, capture our attention and our imaginations. I mean, who could resist a gravitational monster with a giant hungry maw that's just waiting to grab you and devour you if you get too close to it? Yes. Excuse us for a second. It's easy to forget that the idea of a black hole hasn't always been around. It had a beginning. And at first, the idea was so outlandish that most people just didn't believe that these monsters could even exist. Tonight, I am very pleased to introduce our speaker, Marcia Bartusiak. She is a renowned author, journalist, and professor of science writing at MIT. Her books include The Day We Found the Universe, Archives of the Universe, and Einstein's Unfinished Symphony. Tonight, Marcia will present her newest work, Black Hole, How an Idea Abandoned by Newtonians, Hated by Einstein, and Gambled on by Hawking Became Loved. This book tells the story of the fierce black hole debates and the contributions of Einstein, Hawking, and other leading thinkers, and how they revolutionized our understanding of the cosmos. Please welcome Marcia Bartusiak.
Thank you, Christine, and thank you all for coming out on this wonderful spring evening. And to get started, I'd like to read the opening paragraph from my book. The very notion of a black hole is so alluring. It combines the thrill of the unknown with a sense of lurking danger and abandon. To imagine a journey to a black hole's outer boundary is like approaching the precipice of Niagara Falls and contemplating the vertical plunge to the churning waters below. For any astrophysicist at a cocktail party, it's the cosmic object they're most likely to be asked about. And for good reason, a black hole is wackily weird. As noted black hole expert and Caltech theorist Kip Thorne has written, like unicorns and gargoyles, black holes seem more at home in the realms of science fiction and ancient myth than in the real universe. But they are real, and observations over the last few decades only makes the proof more and more certain. Astronomers are now really fairly sure that a supermassive black hole resides in the center of every major galaxy. In fact, it may be linked to the very construction of a galaxy. And a stellar-sized black hole, the result of an aging, massive star imploding at the end of its life, forms somewhere in the universe each and every second. Here's a little clip showing a black hole swallowing up a passing star. Don't want to be a planet around that star. Well, black holes are very popular in our culture, as witnessed very recently by the movie Interstellar, which of course prominently features a black hole. And even earlier, do any of you remember this, in 1979, the Disney movie Black Hole, starring Ernest Borgnine, for those of us of a certain age. And an R2-D2 wannabe robot. really one of the worst movies I've ever seen. As one critic wrote, the science of this fiction is as hokey as the drama. Well, with all this modern imagery, you might be surprised to learn that the idea of a black hole actually had its origin in the 18th century. In fact, in a very idyllic setting, the town of Thornhill in West Yorkshire, England, specifically involves the clergyman of this church in Thornhill. John Mitchell was a former scholar at Cambridge, and at the age of 39, he decided he wanted to marry and become a reverend in the Church of England. So he went and took over became the pastor of this church in Thornhill. He's little known today, but he was, as one science historian described him, the most inventive of the 18th century natural philosophers. He's actually the father of modern seismology. He was the first to suggest that earthquakes were the result of waves moving through the Earth's crust. And he was good friends, as the sign there says, with all of the era's top scientists. He hung out with William Herschel, Henry Cavendish, Joseph Priestley, even Ben Franklin when Franklin was in England. And he continued his scientific studies while he was at Thornhill. And in 1783, right after England was getting over its war with America, he wrote this paper, which made the very first suggestion that black holes exist, or at least the 18th century Newtonian version of black holes. And they certainly don't make titles like this anymore. Here it is. On the means of discovering the distance, magnitude, etc. of the fixed stars in consequence of the diminution of the velocity of their light, in case such a diminution should be found to take place in any of them, and such other data should be procured from observations as would be farther necessary for that purpose. Let me catch my breath. Well, it was in this paper that he imagined a star about 500 times wider than the sun and with the same density. That would extend the sun past the orbit of Mars. And it is at that point that Mitchell calculated, using Newton's law of gravity, that, quote, all light emitted from such a body would be made to return towards it by its own proper gravity. In other words, the photons of light, like a water fountain, the photons of light were like particles of water that would rise up, and then at a certain point, gravity would take hold and they'd fall back down. That means that the light would never reach our eyes, and this star would be a dark pinpoint on the celestial sky. It was the Model T version of a black hole. And the French mathematician Laplace independently came up with a very similar calculation. But in the end, the idea just went away, fortunately. First of all, because Mitchell and Laplace had the wrong theory of gravity, and they had the wrong theory of light. This could not possibly happen in the universe the way they were working it out. Proving the existence of such stars required far more advanced theories of light and gravity. It had to await the 20th century's most inventive natural philosopher, Albert Einstein. This November will be the 100th anniversary when Einstein introduced his momentous general theory of relativity, which could at last handle problems in gravity where Newton's laws broke down. General relativity is required when you have immense concentrated objects of matter in the world of compact stars, galaxies, and in the universe at large. He also offered an explanation for the origin of gravity, which Newton's laws couldn't do. He introduced this idea that mass actually indents the fabric of space-time. So what appears as if we are being pulled down by gravity. We're actually just following the warps in space-time. The moon, for example, is caught circling in Earth's space-time well. Well, this set the stage for the modern concept of the black hole, but not from Einstein, but actually from another person altogether, the German astronomer Karl Schwarzschild, then director of the Potsdam Observatory in Germany. Schwarzschild's great accomplishment just a few weeks after Einstein came out with his theory of general relativity was the first full solution to Einstein's equations. And what's even more astounding is where he did this. He did this during World War I when he was posted on the Russian front with gunfire close by. And he's working out his first full solution to Einstein's equations. Einstein had used approximations when he was making his predictions that light bends by the starlight can bend by the sun, or that there's extra tug on Mercury's orbit. But Schwarzschild came up with the first exact solution, and he did this by introducing a new set of coordinates, spherical coordinates, which allowed him to map the gravitational field around a star like our sun. But in doing this, he ended up with a whopping predicament. Here's an illustration of what Schwarzschild did. He imagined, to make his calculation easier, he imagined all the mass of the sun squeezed into a point at the center. Then he mapped how particles of light would then, as it approached the sun, how they would be then drawn towards the object. And what he found was this. Around that dense point, there emerged a spherical region where the particles just stopped. They approached the sphere and then they just vanished. From his paper, time stopped. Space stopped, time stopped, the particles stopped. If our sun, which is a million miles wide, just about, were squeezed down to a point, this spherical boundary would be about a little under 4 miles wide. This came to be called the Schwarzschild sphere, or the Schwarzschild singularity. Some called it the magical sphere. Astronomers and physicists were just simply flummoxed by this result. But they thought, oh, it's just an artifact of the spherical coordinates. And astronomers weren't worried at all. They said, well, a star is never going to collapse to a point, so why worry about it? And that's exactly what Schwarzschild concluded himself. He said in his paper that this problem was clearly not physically meaningful. And alas, he didn't have long to actually pursue this or look into this further, because he contracted a fatal disease when he was there on the Russian front. And just months after he presented his results to Einstein, to Einstein's great delight, he died at the age of 42, so he wasn't able to continue exploring this further. But the discovery of new stars in the heavens right around the same time would keep this problem alive. Astronomers in the 1910s were just coming to recognize the white dwarf star, a star no bigger than our Earth. This is actually going to be the fate of our sun when it gets into its senior years. Its outer envelope will whisk away, and what remains is the hot core of the sun, which is indeed what turns into the white dwarf star. And by 1930s, astronomers learned, you know, it might not stop there under certain conditions. And that question was taken up by this young man, Subramanian Chandrasekhar, known to one and all as Chandra, who had just graduated from the University of Madras in India and won a scholarship to go on for graduate work at the University of Cambridge in England. And he journeyed from Bombay on this ship, the Italian steamer, the Pilsner. And during that voyage, he began to ask, what happens to the white dwarf if it gets just a little more mass on top of it? Well, with plenty of time to think, as the boat traveled through the Suez Canal into the Mediterranean, he had an epiphany. He carried out a calculation right on the ship, and he saw that there was a limit to the white dwarf mass, which we now know as 1.4 solar masses. Now, Chandra wasn't the first one to actually arrive at this calculation. An English physicist, Edmund Stoner, also found a similar limit, but he and others thought of it as the ultimate compaction of a star, the highest density that atoms could cram themselves into. But Chandra suspected something else was going on. He used a more sophisticated model of a star to arrive at his answer, and more than that, he pressed the issue over and over again. What happens to the star? He, more than anyone else, wanted to know the astrophysical consequences. Well, he continued working on this problem over the years, and at last, within a few years, got an exact solution, and his conclusion was glaringly blunt. When the central density is high enough, the configurations then would have such small radii they would cease to have any practical importance in astrophysics. The graph in his paper that he had completed showed it all. The white dwarf gets smaller and smaller with as it gets more and more massive, and then it at a certain weight, it simply shrivels up and goes into nothingness. Well, this was an astounding finding, and Chandra was invited to give a talk to the Royal Astronomical Society on January 11, 1935, which turned in to one of the most notorious intellectual duels in the history of astrophysics. Chandra dutifully presented his results, which were greeted by polite applause. And afterward, Sir Arthur Eddington, England's most famous astrophysicist at the time, got up to respond. Eddington was the world's expert on stellar physics, and he was not at all pleased to hear of Chandra's idea of drastic stellar collapse. Whereupon he made his infamous statement, so often quoted, "There should be a law of nature to prevent a star from behaving in this absurd way." Well, Chandra was mortified by the laughter of the audience. He couldn't understand why Eddington was doing this. He had consulted Eddington throughout his calculations. Eddington even gave him his calculator that he was using. But Eddington had a bias, and he waited until this meeting to make it known, ignobly enough. He simply didn't like how Chandra had set up his stellar model. And then there was the psychological factor. Where could all that mass possibly be going? It's surprising, but after this little tumult, they actually remained cordial to one another. They went on picnics and bike rides. But inside, it really hurt Chandra. It really greatly affected him. In fact, he soon after moved to America, where his work was greeted more warmly, and he completely abandoned this project and went on to other problems in astrophysics. And he never speculated. He was actually very conservative. He never speculated on what happened to the star. For a while, he went along with the other astronomers who thought, oh, a star likely loses a lot of mass and never reaches the point where it's going to collapse like that. But others did speculate. Astronomers like Fritz Zwicky and Walter Bodd in California. During the years that Chandra was working on his calculations, particle physicists had actually discovered a new particle. Along with the proton and electron, they discovered the neutron particle as part of the atomic nucleus. That was in 1932. And within a year, Zwicky and Bod were suggesting that some stars could completely explode at the end of their life. This was a new idea, stars exploding. And on top of that, they were saying that the core of that star, all those protons and electrons, would be compressed to form a ball of neutrons, a neutron star. Well, astronomers love the idea of stellar explosions because that explained a lot. They had often seen, they were used to nova, you know, a nova showing up. But every once in a while, like once a century, there would be a particularly bright one, and they couldn't explain why was there this brighter one. So they liked the idea that this was an exploding star. Oh, but did they laugh at the idea of a neutron star? No way. They just dismissed that outright. But the idea of neutrons was in the air. Other physicists were starting to talk about it, and it was taken up by this man, J. Robert Oppenheimer, in 1939, who then had dual positions at both Caltech and the University of California at Berkeley. He wanted to find out if neutron stars were physically possible. And to find out, he teamed up with one of his graduate students at Berkeley, George Volkoff. Now, they ignored any idea of stars blowing up. He was just concerned with the neutrons, the neutron star. He didn't like Zwicky very much, so he just wanted to focus on the neutron star and stay away from talk of stars blowing up. Instead, he and Volkoff focused on the neutron core. In fact, notice that in their paper, they used the word neutron cores. No mention of neutron stars as Zwicky used it. Oppenheimer really didn't like Zwicky. And Zwicky was really mad that he wouldn't use the word neutron star. And they studied the neutron star the way Chandra did the white dwarf. And they discovered that neutron stars would be stable up to a point. Just as the white dwarf had a limit, they discovered that the neutron star had a limit. Past a certain mass, the neutrons would, well, they wouldn't stop collapsing. They'd be contracting and contracting. What becomes of the star at that point? The question of what happens, they wrote in their paper, remains unanswered. But no one was panicking as yet. You know, physicists were just learning about, you know, condensed matter. They figured probably other forces come into play. So they weren't worried quite yet. So Oppenheimer decided to continue working on this problem, now bringing in a new player, another graduate student at Berkeley, Hartland Snyder, who was a whiz in general relativity. This was a problem that required general relativity. And what resulted from this collaboration was this paper titled On Continued Gravitational Contraction. They took a stellar core, and they watched what happened as that core's mass passed a certain limit, now known to be about 2 to 3 solar masses. And they saw that it doesn't settle down as a white dwarf, doesn't settle down as a neutron star. In fact, the neutrons held back by nuclear forces no longer has the strength to hold the collapse of the star back. Gravity takes over, and the star starts collapsing indefinitely. The last light waves to flee get so extended by the enormous pull of gravity from visible to infrared to radio and beyond that the star simply vanishes from sight. Only its gravitational field persists, they reported in their journal article. It was a momentous insight. It was the first modern description of a black hole, and it holds up in its entirety. A paper in 1939 holds up in its entirety to this day. General relativist Werner Israel calls it the most daring and uncannily prophetic paper ever published in the field. So why did it take the field of astrophysics and general relativity by storm? Well, for one, there were those astronomers who still had no reason to believe that a star would absolutely, completely collapse. It still, using Eddington's words, seemed too absurd. And also, notice the date of publication of this journal article. That was the very day that Hitler marched into Poland, igniting World War II. At the same time, there was another paper in that very same issue of Physical Review on nuclear fission, a far more urgent topic on the mind of physicists at the time. Talk of collapsing stars seemed trivial. And so the paper just sort of disappeared into the woodwork. Oppenheimer never wrote on the subject again. He, of course, went on to the Manhattan Project, becoming what we now know as the father of the atomic bomb. His students got their PhDs, went on to university teaching positions, and they never took up the topic again as well. And at the very same time, Einstein was saying baloney to those Schwarzschild singularities. He published a paper just a few weeks afterward in October 1939 in the Annals of Mathematics. And he declared he was presenting a clear understanding as to why the Schwarzschild singularities do not exist in physical reality. But he stacked the deck. He set up his model in such a way that he introduced these sort of false forces to keep the star from collapsing. But it was an illusion. More than that, it was simply bad physics. The conclusion of historians? Well, they consider it a strong candidate for being his worst scientific paper. Oppenheimer and Snyder were right, though nobody was giving them any kudos. Gravity becomes the overwhelming force, stronger than any other, when matter is that dense. But as World War II approached, all that work, Oppenheimer's work, all those papers, they just went into its own black hole. What is largely forgotten now in this era, during the 30s and into the 40s, general relativity was not a big field in physics. There was just a handful of people in the world who were doing any work in it. And there, it was mostly mathematics. They weren't concerned with the physics. After the flurry of excitement when Einstein first introduced it, it went away, and all attention was put on quantum mechanics. General relativity at this time was more admired as sublime mathematical sculpture and having nothing to do with the real world physics departments. There was no physics departments in the world that taught general relativity. Even Oppenheimer, after the war, he became for a while head of the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton, and he advised the young physicists there to avoid general relativity, believing it was a dead end. And Einstein, then in his waiting years, was just down the hall from Oppenheimer at that time. It was not until the late 1950s that interest in general relativity began to slowly revive for a number of reasons. First, there was the space race and the Cold War, which led to the military funding all kinds of basic research, including gravitation. And then there were some unusual catalysts, such as Roger Babson of Babson College here in the area. He was an MIT grad who made his fortune on Wall Street in the 1920s. But he had a deep belief in Newton's law, especially that for every action, there is a reaction. And following that, when he saw that the stock market was going up, 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 he got out before it came down, 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 down. And he became one of the wealthiest men in the 1930s because he got out soon enough. And to honor Newton, to saving him from financial ruin, he established the Gravity Research Foundation. But his goal, actually, was to try to discover an anti-gravity device. He was convinced that just as you have insulators that can insulate you from electromagnetism, he thought that maybe by funding gravity research, he could find a way to insulate gravity. In fact, he erected a number of monuments on college campuses throughout the United States to herald this challenge. There's one, this is the one at Tufts University. He imagined it would reduce airplane accidents. Science historian David Kaiser noted that students would often band together to move the stone around the campus like anti-gravity elves. Well, Babson's foundation was at first considered a joke because of this anti-gravity connection. But eventually, he let that go, and he began to fund essay contests and conferences that actually helped energize the study of gravitation in the 1950s. And the epicenters of this resurgence were in Princeton, New Jersey, at Princeton University, and in Moscow, in the Soviet Union. At Princeton, the effort was headed up by the nuclear physicist John Archibald Wheeler, who decided in his 40s to switch out of nuclear physics and go to general relativity. He thought particle physics was in a moment of chaos, and he thought there was more possible solutions to be made in general relativity. In fact, in 1952, he was the first professor to teach general relativity in the Princeton Physics Department. 1952, that late. And in the Soviet Union, the leader was the noted theorist Yakov Zeldovich. And it's interesting to note that both Wheeler and Zeldovich were very important in each country's nuclear bomb program. Wheeler got into the game because he was fascinated by that darn singularity. He actually saw it as a sign of new physics, that he might find just a whole new approach to physics by trying to get rid of the singularity. In much the same way that Max Planck in 1900, they were facing a similar catastrophe, a sort of singularity in the theory of electromagnetism that he solved with the quantum. And Wheeler thought maybe the singularity with the black hole was a signal that he could find a simulation, a solution like the quantum. Well, over the years, he and his students tried model after model, trying to avoid the singularity. And, you know, perhaps other forces came into play. Maybe the mass converted into energy and radiated away. They did all this, but all of their solutions failed. Zeldovich and the Soviets, on the other hand, never doubted that stars collapsed. They had accepted the Oppenheimer-Snyder results right away. They honored that paper. And by the late, by the 1960s, Wheeler was finally coming around to agree. And a major reason, this is another reason there was a renaissance in general relativity, was the opportunity for researchers to use the same computers that helped design nuclear bombs to simulate the implosion of a star leading to a black hole. In the United States, that work was done at the Lawrence, Livermore National Laboratory in California, which Wheeler often visited, where he had some colleagues carrying out some calculations. That's a picture of what that computer setup was there in the 50s. And just compare the two events here. On the left there, you see the nuclear bomb. It's ignited by an explosion that compresses the core, leading to fusion and the release of even more energy. And that's exactly what happens with the supernova as well. The core of the star collapses, and gravity takes over, and if the core weighs two or three solar masses, a neutron star forms. If more than that, gravity takes over and forms a black hole. Nothing in the universe can stop gravity at this stage. Now, both Wheeler and Zeldovich, since they worked in each of their countries' nuclear bomb programs, were very aware of the similarity between these two processes. But they didn't, because of the Cold War, they couldn't actually discuss it between themselves openly. But there was the time when Wheeler visited Zeldovich in Moscow, and he remembers Zeldovich one day was writing on the board a formula for the explosion of a star. He gave me a wink, and I winked back. He and I knew it came from another context. Well, by the mid-1960s, those computer simulations were strongly indicating that if a star was weighty enough, it would die as a black hole. And with those results, Wheeler totally reversed his opinion. Once determined to get rid of the singularity, he became the black hole's biggest champion. And there was another reason for Wheeler's turnaround also. At the start of the 1960s, mathematicians were introducing new methods to solve Einstein's equations of general relativity, approaches that allowed physicists to better picture a black hole. It made the physics more comprehensible. Before this, everyone focused on the matter. What happens to the matter when it condenses down to a point? But now they were seeing that the black hole itself, with that outer boundary, which we call the event horizon, was an entirely new celestial object in and of itself, one that had its own properties and its own effect on the space-time around it. And almost as if planned, evidence was popping up in the universe that these theoretical objects could actually exist. It was due to the advance of these new tools in astronomy that allowed astronomers to go beyond the visible spectrum. Radio astronomy, first of all, began to flourish right after World War II, as all those radar engineers became radio astronomers. And by the 1960s, they were revealing all kinds of new celestial activities. Something that no one saw coming were quasars. First thought to be radio stars within our own Milky Way galaxy, but soon found to be the centers, the very active centers of young distant galaxies at the far reaches of the universe. The first one found was 3C273 that was putting out the energy of a trillion suns. And after a few years of pondering the possibilities, could it be nuclear energy? Could it be chemical energy? What could be putting out all this energy? Physicists concluded there was only one source powerful enough. That was gravity, matter falling into a supermassive black hole at the galaxy's center. And more than that, the black hole is spinning. And by spinning, it acts like a dynamo, the biggest electrical dynamo in the cosmos that releases jets of radiation from its poles. And also, by 1967, a young graduate student in Great Britain named Jocelyn Bell noticed some unusual signals at the radio telescope she was monitoring, regular beeps, and rather than little green men, which they half seriously considered, they figured that they were actually spinning neutron stars, rotating around like lighthouses, and here on Earth, we receiving that radiation. And once neutron stars were discovered, those compact objects that Zwicky had first imagined back in the 30s, it became easier to accept the idea that there could also be black holes. Now, I've been using the term black hole fairly freely, but that phrase really didn't come about until 1967, or that's what they say. Before 1967, astronomers and physicists would refer to this hypothetical object as a collapsar, a dark star, a frozen star, or the awkward gravitationally collapsed object. Boy, that wouldn't look good on the title of a book. None of this had any great pizzazz. Now, the term black hole has long been attributed to John Wheeler, who told me and others that he first used it at a 1967 conference where he kept saying gravitationally collapsed object, gravitationally collapsed object, and someone supposedly raised their hand in the audience and said, "Why don't you call it a black hole?" And he said he therefore adopted that term. And he later used it at a talk in December 1967 to the American Association for the Advancement of Science. That speech was later published in American Scientist, and this is the article that is often quoted as introducing the phrase black hole. But I found out in the research of my book, there's firm evidence that the term black hole was used at least 4 years earlier and not by Wheeler. The first time the phrase black hole was published was here in Science Newsletter in January 1964. The reporter Ann Ewing was covering a meeting in Cleveland where someone on a panel, not directly named, used the term. And a few weeks later, the science editor of Life magazine, Albert Rosenfeld, published an article on a quasar conference held in Texas where he also used the phrase. He wrote that gravitational collapse would result in an invisible black hole in the universe. I tracked down Rosenfeld, who's now retired in his home in New York, and while many years have passed, he's sure he did not make up that term but heard it at the meeting. Well, there was one person who was both at the Texas meeting and on that panel in Cleveland. His name is Hung Yi Chu, then a young theorist specializing in the physics of compact objects. He actually invented the term quasar. So my question was, and my question to him was, were you introducing a new fun term to the public for these compact objects? And Chu replied to me, no. He did spread the word, he did spread that phrase around at those two meetings, but he told me he borrowed it from someone else. From 1959 to 1961, he was at the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton, and during that time, Princeton physicist Robert Dickey gave a colloquium talking about these collapsed stars where gravity was so strong that no light or matter could escape. Dickey compared it to the black hole of Calcutta. And Chu heard Dickey use this phrase again at other conferences. And it seems reasonable because Dickey's son recall him shouting, "Black hole of Calcutta," whenever a household item went missing. And I think that's a good solution for where our socks go. But Wheeler still deserves credit for spreading the phrase. He was the dean of general relativity, not only in the United States, but the world. And his using the phrase in that official speech gave the scientific community permission to use it. It was no longer just a joke or a funny little phrase. It became the official name for that object. Even though Richard Feynman told Wheeler at one point that he thought Wheeler was being very naughty for using that phrase. But it fits so well because a black hole is literally a bottomless pit in the fabric of space-time. More than that, this is what I love, it pays homage to the very man who began it all, Karl Schwarzschild. Schwarz means black in German. So within a year or two, the term was used in the official scientific literature. However, notice that at first, for the first couple years, they always had it in quotation marks, like they had to keep it a little bit at a distance. It was also the era when black holes were introduced to the public. They became in the headlines the darkest riddle of the universe, the dazzling death spasm of a star, the Bermuda Triangles of space, and my favorite, vacuum cleaner of the cosmos. And the headlines just kept coming, especially when astronomers opened up the field of X-ray astronomy, first with rockets and then with the launch in 1970 of the first X-ray space satellite, Uhuru. This satellite's main discoveries were X-ray binaries, not neutron stars circling companion stars. But there was one celestial X-ray source that was particularly puzzling. It was called Cygnus X-1, and Uhuru took a long look at it. And by March 1971, X-ray astronomers believed this source didn't involve a neutron star at all. They suspected it was a black hole, and their announcement captured the newspaper headlines. Follow-up work by both radio and optical astronomers pinpointed the source. The black hole likely orbited a giant blue star, and all that X-ray energy was being generated as the black hole pulled matter off its companion, and that matter spiraled in, heated up, and released all that energy before the matter finally went into the black hole itself. And by the mid-1970s, orbital measurements were suggesting that the dark companion's mass was at least 10 times greater than our sun, which made the case that this was a black hole. But there was wiggle room in the calculations, and astronomers were divided on whether Cygnus X-1 truly was a black hole or not. In fact, they were so divided that it led to an infamous bet. In December 1974, Stephen Hawking and Caltech theorist Kip Thorne wrote up an agreement involving racy magazines. Hawking bet a one-year subscription to Penthouse that Cygnus X-1 did not contain a black hole. Kip bet a four-year subscription to the British magazine Private Eye that it did. I guess Kip was four times more confident. Verification took some time. It took 16 years. But by 1990, Hawking finally cried uncle and agreed that Cygnus X-1 indeed was a black hole. In some ways, it was very symbolic. Perhaps that was the moment when black holes were accepted as real inhabitants of the universe. So no longer are eyebrows raised at the term black hole. They're as readily discussed at astronomy meetings now as a star, a nebula, or a galaxy. A new black hole, as I said, is born somewhere in the universe every second. About 3,000 have formed as I gave this talk. John Wheeler once remarked, "All the science fiction I need is right out there in front of us." He was absolutely right. Once considered too outlandish to exist, too absurd, black holes have now transformed into the wonderful creatures they are in the universe. Thank you very much.
Questions in the audience?
Yes, right there.
Is it possible that a black hole with its jets of X-rays shooting out, if they come close to a planet or a star system like ours, could wipe out life on a planet?
Close enough, yes. Those jets are tremendously powerful. I certainly haven't worked out the numbers. I'd have to talk to some theorists on that, but those jets are very, very
powerful fairly close in. I would think that if you were passing by, yeah, you wouldn't have a chance. Stellar sized black holes, and this is something Hawking discovered, they do evaporate. But for a stellar sized hole, that's very, very slow. It would take 10 to the 67 years for a stellar sized black hole to totally evaporate. You're asking, do they go away? They'll stick around, but they might, you know, they're not totally vacuum cleaners. Their gravitational, you know, reach goes only so far. So if they clear out the material around them, they'll just be sitting there, an indentation in space-time, waiting for something to come by to eat.
Yes. I've heard that some black holes may actually be inactive or passive to them. If black holes depend upon continual input of energy, how does that state of, if you will, inactivity develop? I mean,
oh no, they're not dependent. They're not dependent on continually getting matter to exist. They will slowly evaporate, as I pointed out, but you know. Beyond all comprehension of time. Hawking imagined that maybe in the Big Bang, some small, very tiny black holes form, perhaps the size of a proton, but with the mass of a mountain. They would be releasing and totally evaporating in an explosion right about now. And gamma ray, there are some gamma ray astronomers that are on the lookout to see if that is possible. But no, black holes, once they form, they are an entity. There is matter there somehow, you know, there in its center, that singularity of compressed matter, and the event horizon, that point of no return, is going to be there for a long time.
Over on the right.
I'm a little perplexed as to how, if you do have an event horizon beyond which nothing can escape, how do we actually get these jets? It seems to be contradictory to me.
Yes. When a black hole is rotated, it develops actually two surfaces. There is the event horizon, the point of no return, but also around that, as it's rotating, is what's called the ergosphere. And that's a sort of gray area that when an object moves into that region, this little area just outside the event horizon, it's possible for matter to go in and get accelerated and escape. And also, as it's rotating, all that matter has electromagnetism. And when the matter ends and the black hole is spinning, those electromagnetic fields are intertwined and form channels coming out of the poles so that matter can come and approach the black hole and some of it escapes. Some's created itself by the rotation of the black hole, creating matter and energy that is boosted out of those jets. Yes. It's a combination of things, but if you enter the event horizon, yes, you can't get out. But it's a lot of activity can happen due to the rotation and due to this this area known as the ergosphere, where matter can get accelerated and get away before it actually hits the event horizon.
Is there a relationship between black hole, dark matter, and dark energy?
For a while, some people were wondering whether black holes were dark matter, but the way that dark matter acts, a whole collection of black holes wouldn't serve that purpose. I don't know if there's any relationship between that and dark energy. Dark energy is a component of, you know, space-time itself. In the, you know, as the universe was created, it also in every area of space-time, there is this dark energy. It's not related to black holes.
And the balcony?
No, I think it was probably a similar question, but what does happen to the matter? I mean, does it become antimatter? Is that an old-fashioned thing that I picked up as a kid?
They once talked about white holes, the reverse, you know, where the matter would come out. That's gone away. They honestly don't know. What they need is a complete unified theory combining quantum mechanics with general relativity. And this is an area of great excitement among physicists. The black hole serves as where gravity and quantum mechanics come together, and they're hoping a better understanding of black holes may lead to a better understanding. In fact, general relativity is a very classical theory, and according to that theory, yes, you cross the event horizon, you get noodleized, stretched out, and plunged to the center, and you're just compressed to a point. Quantum mechanics, they're starting to play with this, and they're wondering if instead you go through the event horizon and you're faced with a barrage, a firewall of active particles where space and time itself are breaking up. They don't know yet because they don't have a full theory of quantum gravity. They won't know an answer until they find that. But right now, there's all kinds of speculations. It's fun. Yes?
I read your book, and I loved it.
Great.
I actually read it 2 times.
Ooh.
Thank you. You have a really good vocabulary. I learned a lot of words. But I have 2 questions.
Sure.
How long did it take you to do research? Because there was a lot of information in there. And how long did it take you to write that?
Oh, gee. I spent off and on, because I also teach, so I did it in and around my teaching responsibilities at MIT. I spent about 4 years. I went to various archives. I went to the American Philosophical Society in Philadelphia, where John Wheeler has all of his papers. He passed away a couple years ago. And he put all his papers there, and I went through all his correspondence and all his notebooks. Oh, that was so fascinating. I actually had in my hands his first notebook where he had put on, I have just been informed by my department chairman that I am to teach a course in general relativity. It was the first sentence in his relativity notebook. And then he had a series of like 20, 30 of them after that. But that was the first one in 1953, 54, I forget the thing. So I did a lot of library research. I talked to a lot of people who are still living. Werner Israel, who I mentioned, lived through a lot of this through the 50s, 60s, and 70s. He's a retired physicist in Canada, and I got to talk to him. Talked to a lot of people and put it all together. Once I got the research done, then the writing probably took about a year, off and on. So, but lots of fun learning new things. It's always fun learning about, you know, who hated whom.
All right, we have time for 2 more questions.
Presumably it's not creating an energy, it's not sucking in.
Yeah.
Nothing can escape it. How do you detect them?
The activity is really what the current astronomers need to spot them, to see the X-ray energies and the radio energies and all that energy coming off before the matter gets swallowed up. But there are some people, originally when they were first, you know, looking into this, they were thinking that if a black hole was going through like a big cloud of gas and dust, they would sort of see a track. And I think some people are actually still looking into that to see if that's a possibility, to track those inactive black holes. But yeah, unless they're having an effect, hard to see. That's in fact why people at first didn't even, you know, bother to look for them, because they didn't realize that it's really the accretion disk of matter spiraling in that makes them visible to everyone else.
We have a very eager person.
Oh, I have to have the balcony here. Hi there.
When you talk about stellar mass black holes evaporating, is that the matter in the black hole returning to the universe?
Or some of it, yes. Yes. Stephen Hawking discovered this. In the 1970s, he decided to look at the black hole, and the movie about his life gets it all wrong. to look at the black hole from the perspective of an atom. And he was looking right at the event horizon. And from an atomic perspective, it's a tumultuous place, particles going in and out of existence. And he figured that quantum mechanically, you could have a matter particle and an antimatter particle pop up out of this gravitational energy. And probability is one would go into the hole and one out. And that means that some of the energy of the hole was evaporated out away from the hole, while half of it remained in. And so over time, slowly, bit by bit, like I said, 10 to the 67 years, that's a lot. One with 67 zeros. I don't even know if our universe is going to even last that long, especially if it's acceleration continues. So it doesn't matter from our celestial perspective, but quantum mechanically, very interesting.
Thank you.
All right, thank you so much.